107.5 KZL, the number one new music station.
A lot of these kids out in the streets cheering weren't even teenagers on 9/11. They have no idea what life was like before the national security state. So kids, let me explain. Before bin Laden came along, it was possible to get on a plane with an adult-sized bottle of shampoo without having your scrotum cupped by a sweaty, embarrassed man in a clip-on tie.
Times have changed.
To our Celebrate America Bin Laden Bash on the Murphy in the Morning Show. Mike Linane is with us. Green Beret, Special Operator. Mike, welcome to the program. How are you?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Mike, how are you? Mike, can you hear me?
Yes, I got you.
I get so carried away, I didn't even know how to operate the phone anymore talking to you.
You're so nervous.
Mike, I want to ask you a few questions because, I mean, you obviously have some knowledge of how these operations work. But, you know, from everything we hear, I'm not saying that the CIA didn't do a great job. I mean, but for 10 years, they really, I don't think, ever had a solid lead on bin Laden at all. And they developed some information. Everything I'm reading, they developed some information out of Gitmo from somebody there who gave them a guy's name that was supposedly a courier, and then they came up with the family name, and supposedly the Pakistani security people spotted this guy driving through Pakistan, and they started following, and he eventually led them to the compound. And then there was a Leon Panetta of the CIA calls in this admiral and says, all right, we think we know where bin Laden is. Let's plan the mission. And they wanted to they wanted to bomb the place, and they figured that it would take, I think it was 22,000-pound bombs, and it would leave nothing but a crater. Oof. If they wanted to make sure that they were going to get everybody, but they wanted DNA evidence. They wanted to make sure that he was dead, that they had gotten him, and it was President Obama who made the decision to send in the special forces to take care of it. And supposedly they practiced a couple of times on both coasts before they actually went in and did that. Now, they obviously had better intelligence. I mean, when we're hearing this story after the fact, Mike, like between Sunday night and yesterday, I heard the wall around the place was 20 feet tall, then it was 18, then it was 16, this morning it's 15, the house was two stories, then it was three stories. All this different stuff, but they obviously had some eyes on the ground that had better information. But when one of these things is about to go down, how does it work on your end if you're one of the operators?
Well, you know, very often the intelligence changes at the last minute. Mm-hmm. So it took a long time to put it together. That really is more of a tribute to Al-Qaeda's operational security tactics and techniques than to failure on our part. Mm-hmm. But if you don't mind, I'd like to just take a second and talk about Special Forces involvement. I think the press has botched the use of that term. This was not a Special Forces operation. Let me just take a second and explain.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
All Special Forces qualified men earn the U.S. Army Green Beret, and all U.S. Army Green Berets are Special Forces. Anyone without a Green Beret who claims to be Special Forces is a wannabe. Now, I know a lot of SEALs. I trained with SEAL Team 2 extensively. They want to be known as SEALs, not Special Forces, and rightfully so. They have their own record to stand on, and it's a damn good one.
Well, yeah, I read yesterday that I've read a bunch of Dick Marr Chinko's books about SEAL Team 6. And,
right.
You know, they
started SEAL Team 6. But yeah. I'd just like to say one more quick comment.
Oh, okay.
Sure, sure.
SEAL operators have no interest in infringing on the history, record, and legacy of Special Forces.
Okay.
They want to stand on their own record. That is not necessarily true for many Navy admirals and U.S. Marine Corps generals.
Because I hear these terms when I see these operators.
Mm-hmm.
When they talk about SEALs,
right,
and I guess Special Forces when we're talking about Green Beret. But I read yesterday, and then by the way, they won't even admit that SEAL Team 6 exists.
Well, they don't call it SEAL Team 6 anymore, so technically it doesn't exist.
But I read yesterday that if you're a Navy SEAL, you want to be in 6, and if you're, becoming a SEAL is really hard to do, as everybody knows, just as it is a Green Beret. But the washout rate among Navy SEALs who want to become six members is over 50%.
Yeah, their washout rate is a little bit lower than it is for Special Forces. But I tell you, I have never known a Navy SEAL who regretted the assignment that he was in that day. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are real pros, and they're real patriots, and they want to get on and do the job that they're taught to do.
Now, how hard is it? If you're the guy that was in the room that put the two bullets through Bin Laden's left eye, you're a legend in the operator community. I mean, they all know who you are. But how hard? How do you not tell? How do
how
you not
brag
out?
About
how do you
that?
Not tell that story?
Well, I can tell you why, because and that comes to my biggest concern about this whole thing. We failed to provide operational security for the raid participants. You know, we have effectively put a bullseye for Al-Qaeda on members of SEAL Team 6, or its new name, and along with the aviators from the 160th Aviation Regiment and the CIA commander of the operation. The politicians and government spokesmen who released the info about who participated in this raid put these brave Americans and their families at risk. I just think that was pretty gross OPSEC failure.
I hadn't really thought about that, but that's a good point. And yesterday I saw, you know, on websites like TMZ, they're out in Coronado, California. There's a few pretty famous bars out there where the SEALs train on Coronado Island, where ex-SEALs and Navy personnel go to. Well, when the word broke Monday night, this place is packed instantly.
With paparazzi and
with SEALs and Navy personnel. Nobody's allowed in there except SEALs and Navy personnel. So and I read on TMZ, they had a picture outside. Apparently the place stayed open all night and all day the next day. They went through like 38 kegs of beer.
Having a big party.
And like ran out of booze.
I'm sure they did the same thing in Norfolk.
Yeah, and they had, you know, pictures of this place outside, and when I saw that, I went,
might not be the best decision.
And you read in these books, and in fact, in some of Dick's books, that's actually something that happened in his books, where some terrorists would try to blow up the bar where the SEALs hang out.
Yeah, you know, they blew up the La Belle bar in West Berlin a long time ago, but the bar right next to it, the KBS bar, was a hangout for the SFA teams in Berlin, which I was a member of twice.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's a consideration, but I wouldn't expect them to be able to plan an operation and react immediately after our attack, but I would be surprised if there's not retaliation.
No. That was going to be my next question. Mm-hmm. What's the government looking for right now? I mean, they haven't elevated the terror alert.
Well, elevating the terror alert is useless. I mean, in my book that I wrote 10 years ago, I explained what difference is it. I have never found anybody who knew what to do if it went from yellow to orange or from orange to red.
No, very true. I wear tighter underwear.
And get my duct tape out.
And that's it.
Yeah, nobody knows what to do. You have to be prepared in advance. If you're not prepared in advance, you're not going to be prepared, period. It's too late to do it once things start going down.
How can someone prepare?
Well, I think that you provide security for your family by having a supply of food, by thinking about alternate water sources. Getting along, figuring out how to get along without electricity for an extended period. I mean, you prepare by being prepared. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of books out here now. Red Cross has a good one, and it's free, and there's others available that will advise people on, as well as mine. But mine's out of print. Both printing sold out very quickly, and
well, if you need more info, Jared can...
he's a Mormon.
I mean, if someone's... He's a Mormon. They store food around the clock. You know,
the Mormons are great. As a matter of fact, I had a Mormon on my A-team the 3 years I was an A-team commander overseas.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah, we're tough guys.
We have
that was the bicycle division.
Italian located in Salt Lake City that's almost all Mormon.
Wow.
Huh.
Who knew?
You know, they were so courageous.
So you would say...
Yeah, and there's actually a very, very tight and qualified group of Mormons right here in the Triad.
We are aware of that.
I don't want to tell you I'm part of the special forces in the Triad.
Jared goes to the canning place once a month to volunteer. Uh-huh. Katie's been.
I've been.
She's got a can of wheat at home.
One
and,
can.
And
hey,
oatmeal.
Do you really go there?
I do.
Yeah.
Hey, can you get me in? To go there now, you have to be accompanied by a Mormon.
Yeah, the demand is so high now, you have to come with a member before anyone can go
Jared,
anytime.
Jared, you better take him.
Yeah, I'll take him.
Jared, I have to tell you this. Last week, I went down to South Florida for a few days, and I drove, and as I'm driving down the interstate, and I wish I could think of the name of it, because I went two different ways, but in South Georgia and in Central Florida, as you drive along, there were billboards for all these Be Prepared food companies.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
These websites, and there was some superstore down there where you could buy food by the year on pallets. I mean, just billboard after billboard for it.
You see more and more springing up online, like you said, on billboards.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, there's a big demand for it.
It's crazy.
But yeah, I will definitely take you there.
That's the Be Prepared part that Americans are doing to take care of their families.
Well, listen, Mike, I'll give Jared your number, and he'll call you later and arrange for you to get in there.
I'll be hanging out with a Special Forces guy. That's cool.
Yeah. Hey, and in your honor today, I thought we might play something that you would enjoy for you. And thank you for talking with us today. Thanks for your service.
Hey, anytime. I'd do it again.
Bye-bye.
Fighting soldiers from the sky, fearless men who jump and die, men who mean just what they say, the brave men of the Green Beret. Silver wings upon their chest, these are men, America's best. 100 men will test today, but only 3 win the Green Beret.
And when I was a kid, we used to go to the restaurant that my family ran. We had a jukebox when that song came out.
Uh-huh. What would happen?
That's all they played.
Non-stop.
And people would pop a quarter in there and play that thing over and over.
I like it.
It's good. It's catchy.